Hello everyone. Back in January, I was asked if I could explain the example that I showed, or the sand text, the text turning to sand, the text coming from sand. At that point, my graphics card was actually broken, and then I had absolutely no time after my computer was fixed. But now, I'm currently having a weekend where I have some time, so let's talk about the text. We begin by dropping down a text plus tool. I quickly type in the text that I need and choose the font. That's almost looking like a cheap movie poster. And let's increase the size. I'm going to use 0.2. And that's starting to look good. Let's change the color, but I'm not going to use the colors input right here, simply because for another reason that we're going into later, I need the color separate. So I'm going to use a background. And I will change this to a gradient. And let's choose a matte control. And we're going to pipe this in the foreground. And we're going to say combine alpha and post multiply by image. Because otherwise the alpha channel will not be multiplied with our colors. And let's give this a fitting color. So let's begin with our particles. I'm going to drop down a P image emitter and a P renderer. Right now, this will only create particles on the first frame and nothing will happen because we have no forces applied. But one thing you will notice immediately is that if we play this, the speed is surprisingly slow for the few particles that we have right here. And this is because on our P image emitter, the alpha threshold is currently set to 0, and that means that everywhere on our image, including where the alpha is 0, particles will be generated. So if we increase this a little bit, we don't actually will see a difference, but if we play this, suddenly we have real-time playback. Okay, next I'm going to head into the style tab and change this to Engen. I always try to do this at the beginning, so you guys can actually see what's happening. So I'm choosing a circle, and under size control, I'm going to reduce the size quite a lot and increase size variance as well. Next, I'm going to head into the controls tab, and I'm going to increase the position variance a little bit so they're not spawned perfectly on each pixel, but have a little bit of randomness to them. And I'm going to enable lock color to initial frame and create particles every frame. And let's add in our first force. I will choose a pTurbulence and I will drop down a pDirectional force. The pDirectional force is for gravity and the pTurbulence is to give, as the name says, adds in some turbulence. So I'm going to decrease the density for now just so we can work with this a little bit quicker. And another optimization that we're going to do right at the beginning is we'll add in a pKill and set this to when inside region and choose a cube. And I'm just going to place this down here, decrease height and increase width. So when our particles fall out of the frame, they're getting killed and don't live for as long. On our pTurbulence, I'm going to increase X strength, increase Y strength a little bit. And I'm also going to increase the density. The density is simply how high the resolution of our noise is, essentially. I think I've explained this in a previous tutorial. You can think of this as the detailed slider on a fast noise. And let's look at this. And this is heading in the right direction, but you start to see patterns in the noise. And that's why I often go into region and set the region to bitmap. And region mode obviously needs to be when inside region. And what I add is a fast noise and plug that in as the region. And what this will do, this will break up the turbulence a little bit more. But for that to work, we're going to need to increase the detail, increase the scale a little bit. Actually, let's look at this. Add a scale, increase seething rate so we have an animation. And I'm also going to increase contrast a little bit. Yeah, and this is already looking better. But let's increase scale a little bit more and decrease contrast. And on our pTurbulence, actually, we're going to decrease the alpha threshold to 0. Let me show you what this does exactly. I'm going to use a background, and this works on the alpha. So we're going to change the alpha value of our background. Right now, this is set to 1. So the pTurbulence is active everywhere. And if we were to set this to 0, no turbulence at all. And this can be used to gradually change the values, actually. So if I'm going to increase this to 0.1, now we have some slight noise or some slight turbulence going on. And as you can see, we have this kind of banding going on, or stepping is the correct term. So on my P image emitter, I'm going to change temporal distribution to randomly distributed. And ta-da! Now we don't have this stepping. This is because now these particles can spawn between frames as well. Plug back in our fast noise. Yeah, this really helps to break up the noise a little bit more. This is a little fast for my taste. So I'm going to add in a pFriction. We'll add a little bit more of realism to this. Okay, we can increase this. But this is obviously not what we want. We don't want particles to be spawning all the time. We want these particles to start, then the text should be revealed, and then they should stop. And we can do this by simply animating a mask. I'm going to choose a rectangle for this, and I'll plug this into our text. And we need to make this to fill out our whole frame. And we simply need to animate this. So I'm going to go on the side, and I'll animate the center from left to right. Now it's appearing, but it doesn't stop. And of course, because our text doesn't actually have like an edge currently, it's just appearing after some time. So we can fix that by taking a mat control, pipe that in. And now we will choose the same rectangle and pipe that into the foreground input of our mat control. And I'm going to choose a time speed because we need to offset this for a few frames. We'll do that in the time speed, and I'm going to set the delay to -20. And also I'm going to enable feathering on our mask. And on our mat control, the mat control can be used to combine alphas, combine mats. And we're going to change this, the combine mode, to combine alpha. But instead of copy, we're going to choose inverse subtract, where our original mask is beginning and our new mask, or our offset mask, is ending. We now have this line of alpha, which is traveling perfectly fine over our text. And now if we look at this, we have our text appearing in sand, and it's vanishing again. But right here at the beginning, I'm actually going to change this to be a little bit further left, so we don't see the text right at the beginning. And now we also need a way to have our text to stay there, because obviously we want this, we want the animation as we had it originally. At the beginning, I actually wanted to do this using an instanced version of the text. But I think something that would be more interesting is actually using another mat control and rebuilding this a little bit. So instead of piping this into the mask input, we're going to choose another mat control. We will add this to the foreground. We're going to change this to combine alpha. And for now, you don't see a change. This is because I disabled the checkered background. If we enable checkered background, we will see an issue. Our alpha is the complete line that we have right here. And that makes sense because we're simply copying only the alpha channel. So instead of copying, we're going to use minimum. and we're still seeing the text. So I'm going to choose post multiply image because our alpha needs to be multiplied with our RGB values. Now we're right back at where we started when we used this as a mask input, but we can use another matte control, plug that in again, and now only choosing the original rectangle that's keeping our text visible. Plug that in. And again, combine alpha, minimum, and post multiply image. So, and now I'm simply going to copy this from our colors up here. The same matte control. Plug this into the background, plug this into the foreground, and now we have our colors. Okay, we're back. I simply rearranged this a little bit, but the notes are exactly the same. I didn't change any values. Okay, now we have our particles, we have our text. Now we need to add in a image plane 3D and pipe our text into the material input. Now we have our text in 3D space. And let's add in a merge 3D, merge our text and particles. Now let's add in a camera 3D. And I'm quickly going to animate the camera. Okay, now I've animated the camera, and now we can see that the particles are dying way too early. So in our pKill, we simply need to lower the area of our region. The particles are too small and there are too few. So let's increase the size first. Okay, now it's really just about increasing the size to what your computer can handle and what you like. You can also add a time speed here right before our pImage emitter and add a slight offset to the time. So this will cause our particles to be emitted a little bit earlier than the text will, the text is going to appear. And this will make this effect a little bit more successful. And everything else that I did for the scene that you saw already in the previous tutorial was I added in a vector motion blur, as I pretty much always do with particles. And we also need to activate the vector channel. And this is pretty much our final effect. Great, you're still listening. While we're done with the basic effect, there's actually a part 2, which I encourage you to look at, because we will use this as a base, but create a 3D text. And along the way, we're going to solve a lot of problems that I think are a good exercise to learn some problem-solving abilities. So I'll hopefully see you in the next part.